Art and culture are the most precious nucleus of the human spirit. The great civilizations in the history of mankind have made them the source of familiarity and understanding between members of different beliefs, religions, and lifestyles in different environments and in different times. In our contemporary, interconnected, and interdependent world, their role remains unchanged. With their universal language, culture and art remain the property of all mankind, a bridge and means of communication between people, nations, states, religions, and civilizations. They remain the means of mutual understanding, respect, and cooperation. However, the experiences from the wars in the Balkans at the end of the last century show that it is not necessarily the case. Culture, which coupled with language, is the most explicit record of a nation's identity, can also be exploited for conflict with the cultures of other nations as weapons and pretext for their subjugation, denigration, and extermination. As a means of antagonizing various cultures within an intercultural space, of ethnic cleansing on behalf of a chosen nation, nation as an absolute idea, as if all the other nations that co-created the intercultural space in the Balkans are inferior and thus unworthy of their own specific identity and existence, as if they just take up the living space reserved for higher cultures and civilizations. Sadly, human creativity, including culture, can serve as a means of hatred. But it is not only politics that abuses culture. This is also done by religions, that is to say, by religious institutions and leaders. We have often witnessed this in history. Also in the recent Balkan Wars, by all the three major religions in Afghanistan and elsewhere. Identifying a nation and its culture with religion and the latter's glorification does become ground for the conviction that only one true faith enables one true culture. Hence it was possible and permissible in the name of the true faith both to persecute the members of other religions and to destroy their symbols, their culture, and its monuments. The influence of religious institutions and leaders on people's behavior is undoubtedly great, and so is their responsibility. To defend one's freedom and thus one's identity is the natural right of each human being and each nation, but not to the detriment of the same rights of others and those different from us. Freedom presupposes responsibilities, responsibility to oneself and responsibility to others, to individuals and to community. This is even more true for the modern world, which as a common space of humanity is marked by interdependence. The globally interdependent world demands global responsibility, the responsibility of each to all and all to each. This responsibility is incorporated in the needed common ethical foundation, essential for forging relations within an interdependent humanity. Do unto others as you would have them do to you. So respect human life and dignity. These basic ethical principles of coexistence may not be encroached upon nor violated on behalf of any civilization, religion, or culture. If and when this happens, culture ceases to be culture and civilization ceases to be civilization. It becomes the language of hatred, a means of conflict, destruction, and dehumanization of the world, or even cultural hegemony, which certainly none of us wishes. The efforts to strengthen the understanding of the world as an interdependent common space of mankind, which is also intercultural and multi-civilizational, seem therefore sensible and necessary to me. No effort should be spared in a dialogue within such a world and in common action against the language of hatred in the name of whatever or whoever. Such language is a threat to the peace, security, and creativity of mankind, and hence to its culture as a common heritage of mankind. This may also be the answer to the question of what our global civilization will bequeath to its heirs. Thank you very much.